रजसतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमय ॐ शांति 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 ॐ मे द डिवाइन लीड अस फ्रॉम द अनरियल टू द रियल फ्रॉम डार्कनेस टू लाइट From death to immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace. Welcome to the Sunday service of the Vedanta Society of Toronto. And in the service today, is the topic that has been chosen is the one who leads from death to immortality. That is Kashipati Shiva. That is the place where if one gives a body, He attains to immortality. That has been said in the scriptures. The great, where Shiva always resides, and who is the place is the abode of Shiva. Shiva has promised never to leave Kashi. So the speciality of Kashi and Kashipati, so glorious place on this earth, rather, mythologically, it is not on this earth, It is beyond earth. So we'll talk about that, why Kashi is said to be not belonging to this earth, but is free from the domain of any other ruler, any other king, because it is ruled by God, Shiva himself. On Shiva, Swami Vivekananda wrote a beautiful poem in Sanskrit called Shiva Stotram. निखिल भुवन जन्मस्थेम भंग प्ररोहा अकलित महिमानः कल्पिता यत्र तस्मिन् सुविमल गगनाभे ईश संस्थेप्य नीशे मम भवतु भवेस्मिन् भासुरो भावबन्ध द मीनिंग गोज सैल्यूटेशन टू शिवा हुज ग्लोरी इज इमिजरेबल हु रिजेंबल्स स्काई इन क्लियरनेस To whom are attributed the phenomena of all creation, the preservation and dissolution of the universe. May the devotion, the burning devotion of this my life, attach itself to him, to Shiva, who, while being Lord of all, transcends himself. Just see the meaning and depth of Swamiji's poem. Shiva transcends himself, the Shiva that we worship. Having the arms and matted locks and the bhasma and Ganga flowing, that is the form of the great God Maheshwara Mahadeva. But the real form of Shiva transcends that form. That is the supreme bliss. That is the goal of everything in creation. There we come from, there we merge. So that is the goal and cherished wish, knowingly or unknowingly, is all of all creatures. Is Shiva. Second line of the poem, Swamiji writes, Nihita nikila mohe dhishata yatra rudha prakatita paraprema yo mahadeva sangya ashithila parirambha prema rupasya yasya pranayati hridi vishwam vyajamatram vibhutam in whom lordship is ever established who causes annihilation of delusion, whose most surpassing love made manifest, has crowned him with a name above all names, the name of Mahadeva, the great God, whose warm embrace of love personified displays within man's heart that all power is but a semblance of and a passing soul. The whole creation, the whole life, the whole worldly life which we give so much importance, just a passing soul. Here real love is Shiva, the great God. That's what Swamiji wants to see. And he is the Lord of delusion, but delusion of what? Lord of annihilation. Annihilation of what? Destruction of what? Not of the soul, not of the being, but of delusion. Of Maya, of suffering, of bondage, of ignorance, that Shiva destroys fully and grants the glory of the soul to its fullest, highest. That is the Shiva with the love of my heart. So that is what Swamiji writes. With full of heart, the Swamiji himself is called Shiva Swarupa, describing Shiva himself. Like Shankaracharya, who is considered to be the incarnation of Shiva, he's writing poems on Shiva. We'll read from one line from his poem of Shiva Manasa Pujanam. That's so beautifully written. So this is the second line about the Shiva. Vahati Vipula, the third line, Vahati Vipula Vataha Purva Sanskara Rupaha Pramathati Balavrindam Ghurnite Or Mimala Prachalati Khalu Yugmam Yusmad Asmad Pratitam Ati Vikalita Rupam Naomi Chittam Shivastam. Who is there in the Chitta, which is there in the heart, it is Shiva, Shivastam, where Shiva is staying, he permanently stayed there. In which the tempest of the whole past blows, past samskaras are blown away, stirring the energies with violence like water lashed to waves. All our past samskaras are washed away by the power of Shiva. In which the dual consciousness of I and Thou plays on, I salute that mind unstable, centered in Shiva, the abode of calm. When mind is outside in the world, it is unstable. When centered in Shiva, in the our lotus of our heart, it is calm and steady. Janaka janita bhavo vrittaya sanskritascha agana bahurupo yatra eko yathartha samita vikriti vate yatra nantar bahischa tamaha haramide chitta vritte nirodham. Swamiji had described Shiva as the path to sadhana, to attain something, and Shiva's grace flows to one who tries to attain the reality, attain the gist of this human life, where the ideas of parent and produced purified thoughts and endless varied forms merge in the real one, where the existence ends of such conceptions as within, without, the wind of modification being stilled, that hara I worship, the suppression of movements of the mind, Shiva I hail. That is Shiva that Swami Vivekananda describes, granter of the boon of yoga. If Shiva graces grants us, then we'll be established in the yoga. There are two more verses, we're reading that. So this is the Shiva that Swami Vivekananda wants to ascribe, who is always gracious and helpful in the path of our yoga. We want to be with God, Shiva is always there as the steady wisdom seated in the lotus of our heart, always guiding us and trying to remove the duality of I and you, duality of one and many, all merging into Shiva, which transforms himself, transforms the form of Shiva that we understand into the reality which is inexpressible. That is the real form of Shiva. Shiva, we'll talk about Kashi a little later. First, let us try to see Shiva. Shiva's story we know from the Shiva Purana. You must have seen many videos and all those things, stories that come, or you must have read from about Shiva in the verses, through the stories that you read, or you have heard from your childhood. Shiva is that wonderful, wonderful concept of God of the Hindus, where it is very ascetic. Nothing Shiva requires. He doesn't want anything of the world. Such a great renouncer is Shiva. And yet, that very Mahayogi who loves mountains and loneliness, that Shiva, at time needed, he marries Parvati and consorted with him. And at one time Shiva is smearing ashes from the cremation ground. Other time he's smeared with the beautiful fragrant sandal paste. So both aspects, once is yogi sitting alone, another time consort is there, Parvati and two children, Ganesha and Kartikeya, and the bull and the city of Kashi which he rules. Those, all this aspect of Shiva has been said as the balancing between yoga and bhoga, between samsara and paramparamartha. That's this combination that we find in Shiva. Not only the combination of samsara and paramartha, but combination of man and woman. In one body, Shiva appeared as Ardha Narishwara. Divided, humanity divided into men and women. Two groups. No, they are just appearance. They are not two. These are the two aspects of one being called humanity. Humanity is one. Just the two appears that way. Both are needed for the humanity. And that's why Shiva himself appeared as Ardha Narishwara, half Ishwara, half Parvati or Mahadevi, half Mahadeva, half Mahadevi, called Ardha Narishwara. Both combined together, and that formed the society of humanity. Without that, humanity is incomplete. Not only that it is two are needed for the society to be sustained, not only that, both are equal. In Ardha Narishwara, not the Mahadevi is the smaller part and Mahadeva is the greater part. Both are equal halves, sometimes called better halves, but here it says equal halves, Ardha Narishwara. In better half, it's better to say, each one should say better half. Husband will be the better half of wife, and wife is the better half of the husband. Both are the better half for other person. So that's how this society grows, and Shiva is that ideal of Ardha Narishwara, where the bravery, courage of manly qualities, as they say, are equated and has to live with the kindness, compassion, love flowing with heart, where the region with live with the sublimated emotion of kindness, compassion. Those have to make two equal, have to stay side by side. Then only complete Shiva is formed. If you have only one thing and lack another, then you are not a complete human being. So each of us are Ardha Narishwara, not only the men, not only women, but each man and woman is Ardha Narishwara, has to have both qualities of courage, power, bravery, and yet kindness, compassion, love, sacrifice, all has to be there, then only the person is complete. Ardha Narishwara is not only a Shiva. Shiva wants to see every human being, no distinction of man and woman. Every human being is Ardha Narishwara, half God, Mahadeva, half Mahadevi. That Shiva, concept of Shiva is that way. Wonderful concept of Shiva is so beautiful in Indian mythology, in Indian trilogy. So wonderful way that Shiva is expressed. He doesn't care for anything in the world. No name, no fame, no ornaments, no house to live, nothing, no glory, nothing. For his traveling is an old bull, nowhere it gets chance. Ornaments, no, these pearls and diamonds and gold, nothing, all forsaken, all given up. Snake is the ornament. And what he smears? Ash. Ash from the cremation ground, that has become holy for that. In one of our temples, you have to offer that ash from the cremation ground every day. That's called Bhasma Visheka. That is in Ujjain Mahakaleshwara. Every morning, that ash has to be offered to Shiva. Shiva is that being. For him, everything is holy. And people don't find that his retinue, his associates are whom? Hobgoblins, Bhuta, Preta, Pishacha. No, they are all hated everywhere. But Shiva says, come to me. Those who do not have a place, come to me. I will give you shelter. Everyone gets shelter with Shiva. If we are forsaken by the world, Shiva is always there to accept. Oh, come to me. I am there. As Jesus said, those who are tired from the world, weird and labored hard and tired, come to me, I will give you shelter. Much before Jesus said, Jesus in another form as Shiva said this to the whole humanity, come to me. And they all came to Shiva, and they are always welcome to Shiva. Whenever we feel like tired, forsaken, and not loved by the world, there is one who always loves us, and that is Shiva. This concept of Shiva is so beautiful in Hinduism, how this both aspect of samsara and paramartha and sannyasa, both are merged together. Shiva is the lord of the sannyasins, who renounce the world, who meditate, who are the yogis, and also is the lord of women who wants to get married. They also pray to Shiva, may I have a husband like you, perfect, loving, calm. And that is the prayer of people who want to get married. Shiva is the lord of people who have renounced the world, have nothing to do with the world and its enjoyment. Shiva is the lord. What a contradiction, what a combination and consummation of human wishes, all they meet in Shiva. Shiva is the confluence of all desires of human being, and he grants whoever, whatever one wants, that is Shiva. And Shiva is such, he's called Ashutosha, pleased very easily. He is pleased with short prayer. And what does it like in flower? Does it like all lotus flowers or beautiful, other beautiful flowers? No, anything, the wild grown bale leaf you give at the Shivalinga and say, just say Om Namah Shivaya. He loves this mantra, Om Namah Shivaya. And pour some water. If Ganga water, nice, good. No Ganga water, just say Ganga, Ganga, and pour it, becomes Ganga water for Shiva. So easily pleased, whatever you have offered. Wild flowers are very, very liked by Shiva, like Akanda flower. It just grows on the roadside in India, that Calotropis or what they call. So that flower is liked by Shiva. Some like Dhutra, they say, it is liked by Shiva. Wild grown flowers, and no beauty, no fragrance, nothing. But Shiva likes whatever other discard, welcomed by Shiva. From the plants, animals, human beings, the souls who do not have body, like the preta we call, those all have place in Shiva's abode. That Shiva is considered to be the creator of the universe. What, according to mythology, Shiva first created Kashi, the most ancient living city, they say. There are a few other cities, one is in Israel, also one city, they say 2,000-year-old cities, still living. But Kashi is supposed to be much older than that. It's still living, thriving, and it's growing, and for thousands of years it has been fulfilling the cherished wish of the human beings, of the believers, that if we people are afraid of death at other place, but when they go to Kashi, they are not afraid of anything, not afraid of death. Death there doesn't become something terrible, something snatching you from your cherished things, but it is a welcome friend, because there is no law of Yama. Yama is not ruling there. There whoever rules is Shiva. Their dying is not going to Yamadwara. Their dying is going to Shiva Mandiram, Shiva Loka, Shiva Loka Gacchanti. That's what they say, that type of Kashi is created by Shiva. So what happened, the mythology says that Shiva and Parvati, Shiva created Kashi, and with him was Parvati. And then the Shakti was there. It's not the Parvati in the form of Parvati, but Shakti was there. And Shiva thought, I must create someone. And then he created Vishnu. And Vishnu was there, and Shiva, and then Vishnu started, there was nothing, no water was there. Then Vishnu dug a pond, and that pond, that lake, water body reservoir was quite big, and that he did with the help of his chakra. So his Sudarsana chakra, it is called, made that pond. Pond is called in Sanskrit Puskarini. So it is called Chakra Puskarini, made with the help of the chakra of Vishnu, and he did so much hard work, it became the holy Chakra Puskarini. Then Shiva and Parvati came there, and Shiva asked Vishnu, seeing his his work, hard work, asked, what do you want? You brought such a water, you brought water here, a huge pond was there. Now it's a small, and this water pond is there. What happened is, he said, whatever happens, I want to be with you always, Vishnu says. This is the mythology. And seeing the devotion of Vishnu, Shiva's body shook. And he was wearing earring at the karnika, means in the ear, he's wearing money. And that money fell from that in that pond, Chakra Puskarini. After that, that Chakra Puskarini is named Manikarnika. It is one of the holiest Tirtha of Hindus. Holiest, the first Tirtha, they say, is Manikarnika. The Kashi was there, of course, before Ganga came, Kashi was there, they say. And then Ganga was brought by Bhagirath, and Bhagirath took it through the many places. And while taking it, he brought it to Varanasi or Kashi. And the Kashi, he took it to holy places and wherever through ghats, and he took it through Manikarnika, that most important and holiest spot of Kashi. And this Manikarnika, the Kashi, the Ganga flowed through Manikarnika. Now Manikarnika itself was a great Tirtha. Now Kashi is there, the Vishwanatha temple is there, so it has all become very blessed spot. Manikarnika is so holy spot that there is the cremation held. When body's work is done, or work in the world, body has to be cremated, has to be offered to the fire. Its elements which made the body and did so much tapasya and yoga, now it has to be offered to something holy, consigned to the flames. Where to do it? It should be done in the holiest spot. They do at Manikarnika. When the story of Harishchandra, that is said, when Harishchandra was there in Satyayuga, perhaps that was on the bank of this Manikarnika pond, not the river Ganga, is a cremation ground from earlier times. Harishchandra did there, not on the Manikarnika that we have the cremation places and Manikarnika on the bank of Ganga, but on the bank of that Manikarnika pond, that Tirtha, there was Harishchandra's Harishchandra's cremation. He was in charge of cremation of that Manikarnika, that was there. So, what happened with Harishchandra's story? Then I will come to Kashi. So, Harishchandra, he was a very truthful person. Whatever something he commits, he follows that to the, he will sacrifice everything. Once in his dream, he saw that he has given his whole kingdom, which consisted of known India at that time, known world, he gave to one rishi. He just gifted that. Now woke up, he found he is not gifted, it was a dream. Then because he has gifted even in dream, now he invited the rishi and really said, I have already gifted that, now it is yours. I cannot stay here. I have already gifted. Now rishi was also like that. He said, you have gifted to me, to give something, you have given the dakshina. You have given something, there is some money has to be given to complete your gift. So how will you give your dakshina? And he said, how can I give? He said, I have nothing, whatever is there, kingdom is all given to you. Now you have to earn money and go beyond the kingdom. Kingdom is now mine, you have given it. Now where to go? Then rishi said, go to Kashi. Kashi was not your kingdom. Kashi is the kingdom of Shiva. Go there and earn money and give that as Guru Dakshina. And all sorts of thing happens in his life. All turmoil comes. Wife becomes his wife, the queen of the whole empress of India, becomes a servant in one person's house. And his small son, Rohitashwa, becomes the flower that is attending some errands of that man who employed him, and the king Harishchandra himself becomes the guard and the guide of the cremation ground called Dome, doing the most menial work. So that story goes, but it says that Kashi is the place that doesn't belong to you. He may belong to, the whole world may belong to you, but Kashi belongs to Shiva. That is the story. Kashi itself means shining. Effulgent, it's the glorified, that is the meaning of Kashi. Before the name Kashi was there, it is other name also. It is one of the name of Kashi is called Anandavana. Anandavana is the joy, the forest of joy. When there was not much city, but it was filled with Ananda, that's why it's called Anandavana. Tulsidas writes beautiful poem, Anandavana Girijapati Nagari Manakyo Nahi Vasa Lagavatare Kashi Samana Nahi Dvitiya Puri Brahmadi ke mana bhavatare. Kasi is so glorious, there is no other city that will enchant your mind. Even Brahmas love to stay in Kasi. Why don't you see live in Kasi? It is Girijapati Nagari. It is the city of Shiva, Girija's husband, Parvati's husband. That is the city of Kasi. It is Anandavana. It is like the forest of bliss. That is Kasi. The effulgent, shining Kasi. That is what saying. Who is saying that? Saying this Bhakta, devotee of Rama, who wrote Rama Charita Manasa, the famous Hindi Ramayana, that Tulsidas, devoted Tulsidas, says about the Kasi. You must love Kasi. Tulsidas himself lived in Kasi, loved Kasi, composed Ramacharita Manasa in Kasi. That is Tulsidas' love. Anta samaya shambhu sada shiva taraka brahma sunavatare. That is the glory that I am going to tell you. What is the glory of Kasi? Why people love to die in Kasi? They say, this is the thing. Anta samaya shambhu sada shiva taraka brahma sunavatare. There Shiva gives the Taraka mantra, the mantra that will take you across this samsara of birth and death. That Kasi is, why don't you love and live in the Kasi? Just love and live in the Kasi. Aisa Kasi kyo nahi seve, Shita sambhu sada bhavatare, Tulasi dasa bhajagave mahadeva, Kasi parama pada pavatare. Anandavana Girijapati Nagari. Tulsidas sings the glory of Kasi, where Shiva is always there, Paramapada Pavatare. If you live in Kasi, and there you find the supreme abode of Kasi, Paramapada, and where Shiva Shambhu is always served. That is the glory of Kasi, where whole Hindu culture, Sanatana Dharma, is the center of Sanatana Dharma, right of devotee of Rama. He loves Kasi so much. And what about Kabirdas, the famous saint and poet who loves God in formless aspect, that also lived in Banaras and wrote beautiful poems. If you go to Banaras, still now also you will find there written on the wall the ephemerality of this life. It goes. There it says in the walls, you will find written, Chalti chakki dekh kar diya kabira roy, dvi patan ke beech me koi sabut bachana koi. This huge, this grinding stone is moving one on another. And like the wheat used to be made flour by grinding through the grinding stone. One down, one up, and one the upper one was to move. And whatever grains were there, all crushed to become powder. So this whole universe, the world is like a powder. This earth is the lower stone, and sky is the upper stone. Whatever is there between these two, dvipatan, has to be crushed to powder. And Kabir Das cries seeing that, weeps seeing no one will be saved, no one will remain intact, all will have to be crushed in between these two stones. That Kabir Das says, saying that don't be proud of your human form, human existence as you have. It will go, it will be crushed between these two stones of the grinding stone. So don't be proud of that. If you are proud, you will have to cry. So Kabir Das goes to spiritual feeling, says don't rely on this material formed aspect of yourself. It will be crushed and gone. No one has been saved intact between these two stones, says Kabir Das. It will find written in the gully, in the lanes of Kasi. So as I said, Kasi is a very shining, the name is shining, place. Kasi is also called Avalokita. That was the older name of Kasi, Avalokita. So that name is also referred, and also is referred Kasi and Anandavana. Those are all old names of the Kasi written. So why it is shining? does it shine? If you go to Kashi nowadays, you'll find earlier it was there, now Swachh Bharat is doing a little better. Earlier it was very dirty, people threw things here and there, cows roaming, cow dung is in the streets, and it seems to be so dirty, and yet it is said it is shining, effulgent, blissful. When Sri Ramakrishna went there, he saw from across the Ganga, Kashi made of gold, shining. What did that made of gold means? How did he see shining? Kashi is made of like stone and bricks like any other place, any other city. But Sri Ramakrishna saw it shining, real Kashi he saw in his bhava from across the river before approaching the Kashi. So because it is made of so much spirituality is condensed in Kashi from thousands of years. It is those who can capture, who didn't go to Kashi, we found that Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva all want to live in Kashi. And Shiva is the, always living in the Kashi. It's also called Abhimukta, Lokavate, I said. It is Abhimukta, it is said. So why is it Abhimukta? Na Abhimukta, not being free. Because someone said, I will never leave this. It is never forsaken city. Who doesn't leave Kashi? It is Shiva, who is always there, ready to help every human being, every being. Whenever one dies, his duty is never finishing. We go on dying there, people go to die, and Shiva has to come to every soul to come to Manikarnika to give Taraka Mantra, as Tulsidas, Taraka Mantra, Sunavatare, like that it says. And it is just said here, Tulsidas doesn't say how this Taraka Mantra is shown. It is Sri Ramakrishna first who said, he saw in the vision how this mantra was told. He was, Sri Ramakrishna was going with our Mathur Babu and his team on the boat. It was a boat, like a houseboat, some portion was covered. It's called Bajra, they call in Kashi. And he was going, suddenly they gradually came towards Manikarnika. And seeing the Manikarnika pyres, I mean Manikarnika will find always some body is burning. So the Manikarnika, they went and Sri Ramakrishna, the body burning, the burning of the flesh, that smell came. Sri Ramakrishna came out of the house, of the houseboat, on the boat, and came to the edge of the boat. And Mathura Babu rushed there so Sri Ramakrishna may not fall. And Sri Ramakrishna remained standing still there on the boat, watching towards the burning pyres of Manikarnika. For some time he was in Samadhi. They were ready to catch a fall. They didn't touch him. And later on Sri Ramakrishna said that a thing was revealed to him. He could see, Sri Ramakrishna could see that when a dead body was brought, Shiva would lift that soul from the dead body and give in the ears of this soul the Taraka Mantra. What is the Taraka Mantra is not known, because mantra is given by someone to someone else. It is secret. So Taraka Mantra was given, that which takes you across this birth and death cycle is finished. You have attained the goal of existence. So that is the goal that they attain. And Mother Kali is there opening all the knots of gross, subtle and causal bodies, and all is set free forever. Mukti is attained just by dying in Kashi. That is the glory of Kashi, and Sri Ramakrishna saw this in vision. So that's what, how Sri Ramakrishna saw. Two things Sri Ramakrishna, very wonderful, special. He saw Kashi really made of effulgent, that he saw the shining and effulgent, and another he saw how this Taraka Mantra is given to the soul before, and the soul is liberated. Kashi, you must have heard the story that this Vishnu and Brahma were fighting, this mythology. Who is greater of them? Because Vishnu and Brahma both are the one, two of the trilogy, the trio, holy trio, Trinity. Then there they were fighting, and suddenly I say I am bigger, and another say I am greater than you. Suddenly from the ground one fire flame arose, and that flame went up in the sky. They saw up, they could not find the end of this. Down from where it is coming, they don't know. So they both thought, now let us measure this thing. Which this has come in the form of fire, Jyotirlinga, the linga of fire. And they, Brahma went on his son and went to top to find the end of that. And Vishnu took the form of boar and went down on the earth to find the beginning of that fire, Jyotirlinga. And both came back not finding the beginning or the end. That is Shiva. The Shiva says, I am infinite. They cannot find. They all bowed down to that and he appeared as Shiva. So Shiva, Jyotirlinga means that. That is the real meaning of Jyotirlinga, bright linga. Shiva is worshipped in linga, or the symbol of Shiva is called Shivalinga. So Shivalinga is various kinds and different names are given there. But Shivalinga is said to have five faces. It represents five things. What are the five faces of Shiva? Panchavaktram Trinetram we call. There Shiva has five faces and each face has three eyes, Trinetram. What are the five faces? One is called Srishti face, another is called Sthiti face, the creation face, the sustenance face, Pralaya or dissolution face, and Tirobhava. And that is the concealed face, the face of concealment. You don't understand what is that. And one face is called Anugraha, the face of grace. That is the Dakshinam Mukham, Rudra yatte dakshinam mukham tena mam prahi nityam. Your dakshina mukha, may that always protect me, that anugraha face of Shiva on the Shivalinga. Somewhere this face is done, like you see in Pasupatinath or some other temple in India. But in many places there are no faces made on the Shivalinga. But Shivalinga represents Srishti, Sthiti, Pralaya, Pralaya, then Tirobhava and Anugraha. All is there in Shivalinga. All is that we find in Shivalinga. Shiva in the mythology says once he had to leave Kashi because there was drought for like 60 years, mythological story. And there was one king, his name was Shatrunjaya, Ripunjaya. So that king was very brave, and Brahma went to him and said, can you help to remain the creation which is falling? There will be no creation, everybody will die. So can you help that to restore the life in the world? So Brahma tried hard and he said, one condition, I can take the charge of whatever you say of the world. All gods have to leave this world. That was his condition. The god of rain, god of fire, god of death, all gods have to leave. And in that failed Shiva also. The Shiva also Kashi, he had to rule Kashi because all everywhere a drought was there. And his name became Divodasa. The servant of heaven was his name. He did fantastic work, restored life and restored the thing came up, but all gods had to leave. Shiva also had to leave. Not because of he said, but there was one devotee called Mandara. He's Mandara, Meru Mandara, the mountain, the top mountain. He was devotee of Shiva. He said, please come to me and stay with me. Shiva went there to Meru Mandara. But Shiva was so much loved Kashi that he wanted to back. So in the story is there, how Shiva wanted to come back to Kashi because he loves Kashi. And after that, he came to Kashi. And then he said, I will never leave this Kashi. That's why it is said that Shiva is Abhimukta. Abhimukta means he will never be forsaken by Shiva. That is the world of Kashi. Kashi has many Shiva temples, and the most prominent of them is Vishwanatha or Vishveshwara, whatever you call. And that is a very old temple, and the Shivalinga is said to be, it's connected to the Jyotirlinga, is one of the Jyotirlinga, very auspicious place and very auspicious form of Shiva. There are 12 Jyotirlingas in whole of India. One is in Kedar, one is in South, like that it is there in Maharashtra, Trimbakeshwar, in near Indore there is one. In Omkareshwar, like that, there are many Jyotirlinga of the 12. Kashi is very important. Even our Gujarat, that is also Jyotirlinga. So that is worship there, and all holy persons have gone there. As I said, Tulasi Das and Kabir Das stayed there. The Shankaracharya and your Ramanuja and Madhva and all great saints went to Kashi and prayed in Shiva temple. In Shankaracharya's time, there might be different temple. Now it has become smaller. There is very glorious temple of Shiva. So Shiva's temple, Sri Ramakrishna went there, Raja Maharaja, all our direct disciples almost have gone and visited Kashi temple. There Shiva lives, and here they feel the presence of Shiva. Only when one goes to that type of temple, one should feel the presence of being and should not see what is dirt and water and rotting willow leaves and the people are all crowding, nothing that. Shiva, the glorious being, is ever present there. Focus, bring out your mind from everything. They say that when they made temples sometimes, they made all beautiful carvings and all that around. Why did they make? That was one question. Some said, when you want to enter the temple, you should give up all your attraction for anything that you may like and put your mind focused on God, then only your visiting the temple will be successful. So that's how in Varanasi, if you go to Vishwanatha temple, all that you will see, crowd, people pushing, but there is Shiva's presence. Forget, ignore all those dirt and pushing and behavior. Just focus on Shiva's presence, the shining bestower of grace, giver of immortality. That is their unattached one ever in yoga. Always in that calmness, that Mahayogi residing there, worshipped thousands of years by millions of people and coming to pray to him for asking for the boons, whatever they like, maybe of the world, maybe of the emancipation, but all is asked to Shiva, and Shiva, he doesn't hold the grace and he gives that to everyone. That is Vishveshwara Shiva. There are many, there is one Kedarnath temple. The Holy Mother said, if this Kedar and that Kedar are same, those who cannot go to Himalayan Kedar, if they come here, it's like visiting Kedar. There with Shiva is his consort. And consort is there not as Mother Kali, but as Annapurna. Annapurna is one form of Kali where she provides food to the people, to sustain them, to keep them alive. And that is what the form of Annapurna. So when people become monks, they have to survive to do sadhana. And they say, Annapurne Sadapurne Shankara Pranavallave Jnana Vijnana Siddhyatam Vikshyam Dehime Parvati. Oh Parvati, oh Annapurna, please grant, give me some arms to keep this body intact so that I can succeed in attaining jnana and vijnana. What is jnana and vijnana? You have to read gospel to understand that. Jnana itself is knowledge. What is vijnana? The true knowledge, the ultimate knowledge. Both are to be sustained by the gift of food and care given by Parvati and the grace of Shiva. Then you will attain jnana vijnana. Sannyasi will ask like that. Others will ask whatever problem or demands or needs of the world that they do in the Shiva temple and in the Annapurna temple. The Annapurna temple is not very far from Shiva. There are many great ghats when the Ganga flew. The speciality of Ganga in Kashi. Why this Kashi became so, Ganga became so important in Kashi? Kashi is before even Ganga came. That is the story. Because Ganga here flows all through its course, Ganga flows from north to south to reach the Ganga Sagar in Bay of Bengal. But in Kashi, it flows from south to north. That is special flow of Ganga, that somehow the land is that way, the Ganga flows from south to north, and that has become the very holy and very city of Kashi. The Ganga is bent and looks like the Shiva Dhanu, the bow of Shiva, the holy bow of Shiva. That is the shape that Kashi has stayed. It's 5 crosses, they call, about 10 miles square. That is very holy, and whoever dies there is liberated, that is the saying. In living in Kashi, life is transformed by the grace of Shiva. In the morning, spiritual current flows And those who do sit down morning and do tapasya, they get much more benefit than doing in any other place. The place has a, the city has that vibration, always the spiritual current flows most in the morning, early morning Brahma Muhurta in Kashi. So there, whatever you do, it increases many fold. That's why they say people all get up early in the morning and many go to take deep in Ganga and then go to Vishwanatha temple, then come to their rooms and houses first, finish their morning rituals, prayers, and they are engaged after that into their daily job, business, work, transportation, whatever you have, teaching, whatever you have. The first thing is their spiritual basis of life that is obtained there. So that is the great thing, thing in the Kashi. Life is transformed in Kashi. They say, if you live in Kashi, already everything is done. The sadhana is important, but for those who do not do Kashi, the thing it do in the Kashi. The Shiva Manasa Puja Stotra of Shankaracharya, at the end he says, Atma Tvam Girija Mati Sahachara Prana Sariram Griham. In there you feel that my Atma is Tvam. Oh Shiva, you are my Atma. You are within me. I don't have to search anywhere. If you can develop so much spirituality, you don't have to visit even Shiva temple. You have the visiting Shiva temple, taking daily deep, all has to develop in finding Shiva within yourself and within the heart of everyone. Otherwise, this transformation has to come. This change has to come. So, Atma, Tvam, and my mind is Parvati, Girija. You are my mind, my intellect is you. And my prana is your sahachara. All your retinue, all your attendants are my prana. And this body is your house. Shariram griham. Pujate visayop bhoga rachana. I eat so many things, I see so many things, the visaya that come in within me, all that is puja. I don't have to offer flowers to the Shivalinga. All I intake is like puja. Whatever you eat becomes offering to Shiva in Kashi. That is the glory of Kashi. You have to just think of it, remember this thing, that whatever you are eating is not anything but is offering to the Shiva that is remaining inside as your Atma, as your very, very core that is there. So everything becomes like the offering to Shiva. And when you sleep, that is not the sleep, it is samadhi, nidra, samadhi, sthiti. In Kashi only it is possible. When you sleep, you are going to samadhi as it were. It is so holy place. And sanchara, you walk around city for different cause, that all become pradakshina of your temple. Their walking itself become pradakshina. Sanchara padayo pradakshina vidhi stotrani sarvagiro. And whatever the chants, many people, if you go to Shiva temple, Vishwanath temple in the morning, you'll find people reciting Shiva Mahimna Stotra, Rudrashtakam, all those people reciting. But in Kashi, whatever you speak, your very words, that become the stotra for Shiva. That's what it says. Stotrani sarvagiro. Whatever you eat is offering. Whatever you speak is the mantra of Shiva. Stuti to Shiva. When you sleep, it is samadhi. Like that. And Shiva, you are full of Shiva. And yad yad karma karomi tattad akhilam sambho tavaradharam. Whatever I do, that is worship to you, O Shiva. Shiva Jnane Jiva Seva. Sri Ramakrishna taught this thing. You have to serve beings with the knowledge of Shiva in you and in others. All it is Shiva that you are worshipping. Whatever help you do, whatever service you do, whatever work you do, it becomes Shiva Pujanam. Yadyat Karma Karomi Tattad Akhilam Sambho Tavaradhanam. So that is what the Shiva is. Everything is in the Kashi is worship of Shiva. That is how it is said. The Sri Ramakrishna himself saw. And what happened to Holy Mother? Holy Mother reaffirmed that whatever or whoever dies in Kashi, he or it gets liberation. Someone said, Mother, this mosquito died, will it also get liberation? He said, yes, Baba, Whatever dies in Kasi has to if anyone comes and dies in Kasi, has to must have done great meritorious work in the past, otherwise it is not possible. And whoever dies here, whatever soul becomes free from the body, is given mantra by Shiva and liberated. That Holy Mother affirms, Sri Ramakrishna sees, Tulsidas says. So like that thing, everything in Kasi is that great because of the Kashipati being there. Grace of Shiva falls on everyone in Kasi. Swami Vivekananda, that's how Shiva's aspect is. So Swami Vivekananda gave one words of caution. He said, when you go to the place of pilgrimage, all your sins or whatever demerit you have occupied by doing wrong things in other places, all are clean in the Tirtha. Take a dip in Ganga, you become purified in body and mind. And Sri Ramakrishna, of course, says that sins are sitting on the tree, they come and jump. Because if you can't give up those, they will again come back. Though you are purified, but you may again get polluted. So like the elephant getting bath. So in the pool you get bath and it comes out and it spreads the dust again on its body, like that. So Sri Swami Vivekananda said, when you are in such a holy place, whatever you have committed, sin or anything in any other place, all are washed away, all are gone by the power of the holiness of the place, like Kashi. But if you commit any sin in Kashi, that becomes manifold. As you commit any good thing, that becomes meritorious. So be careful to lead a pure life in Kashi. And think that stotra I said, then how does it tally? You eat and that is the offering of bhoga. You speak anything to anyone, that is like the stotra. And you sleep, that is like the samadhi. And you walk, that is the production of the temple. How does it tally with Swamiji's caution? When we do those things, we have to be aware that we are worshipping Shiva. If you forget and start enjoying the object that you take, and you forget the Shiva, then it becomes problematic, it becomes not the right thing. If we are aware that everything that you do in Kashi or anywhere, so that becomes the worship of Shiva. And now this Kashi, which is so beautiful, shining city, the abode of Shiva, where the Kashipati is always there to give us, grant us emancipation, which we knowingly or unknowingly have been seeking through our births. After births we have been seeking, not getting it, and we are in Kashi, then we get. What about other places? All cannot die in Kashi. But if we cannot go to Kashi, we can bring Kashi in our mind. For that we have to think of Shiva or our Ishta always within us. And be with Ishta and know that we are doing everything for the sake of Ishta. And whatever we do, Ishta is always residing within our heart. We have to see the Ishta there in our heart. Shiva in the form of our Ishta is there, and he is sure to grant us liberation at the end. And like when we die to Kashi, there is liberation. When we are Ishta at the time of death, when we think of only of our Ishta, Ishta, who is the form of Shiva, will give us Taraka Mantra. Mother Sarada, with another form of Parvati, is open our all knots of gross, of subtle, of causal existence, and make our soul free and merge in the Supreme Being. That is what the Kashi can be brought in anywhere when we live in that joy, that purity, that effulgence, that becomes like Kashi. Then it's tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, that we live in ignorance, in the troubles of the world, and the problems, always seeing the petty, minor thing, and getting involved and engrossed in that, and not able to forsake all those, and forgetting the great bliss that we are heir to, and that becomes life like living in the world, engrossed in the world. When we give up that and live with God in our heart, and then it becomes the blissful, shining effulgence. Then we give up tamas and we live in jyoti gamaya. And when we can live like that, then mrityor ma mritam gamaya. Then death will come, but it will be something that we cherish. Like people dying in Kasi are not afraid of death. They are rather waiting for death to come, because death is that glorious event when their cherished wish, that heart always cherished, that is going to be fulfilled, getting liberation. So death is not feared of in Kasi. That's what will become to us here. If we can bring Kasi with us, we will not be afraid of death anymore. Death comes, we are going to have the grace of God, and all my bondage of ignorance will be all cut asunder. The Divine Mother will be there to loose the knots of all my bondage, and I will attain that immortal bliss. That is the fear of death also goes when Kasi is with us. So we cannot go and live in the Kasi, everyone cannot do, but a spiritual person should try to bring Kasi within themselves. Where if the Kashipati is there, if Shiva is there with you, Kasi has come with you, because Shiva said, I cannot leave Kasi. Kasi is always there, that's why Kasi is Abhimukta. Where is Shiva is there, Kasi has to be there. So our job is to be always with Ishta, with the form of great God, Mahadeva. That is our Ishta, came to in the form of our Ishta, with whom we can relate more closely than the legendary or mythological Shiva. So the Ishta becomes very close, most dear, and when he is revealed in our heart, we live for him, we work for him, we do everything for him or her, then the Kasi has come to us. Kashipati is always with us. Let us pray to God, pray to Sri Ramakrishna, that may we live with our Ishta, always remembering him, not even forgetting every time, not any time forgetting him, all the time being with our Ishta, being with Kashipati, then the whole world will become Kasi. The whole world will become out of world, out of this earth, or normal thing. It becomes extraordinary, holy place, shining place, whole world will become Kasi. They say Kasi is like on the trident of Shiva, it is held there. It is beyond world, it is not in the world. Why do they say that? Because in Kasi, so different from other parts of the world. That's why they say Kasi stands on the trident of Shiva. It is held by Shiva, protected by Shiva. Always it will be protected by Shiva. And there in Kasi, the worldly thing cannot touch you. It's very spiritual place. That's why it is said it is beyond the world. In other places, people work and they might be have worldly desires, but when they go to Kasi, it's all the spiritual desires are there. So that's why the world, the Kasi's vibration, Kasi's the whole culture is very otherworldly, in the sense very divine, very holy. That's how the Kasi is. So if we go to Kasi, visit Kasi, don't be diverted by the behavior of any person, by the beggars, by the dirt of the place, but see the spiritual condensation, Shiva's presence in everyone, Shiva in the form of all the people that we meet. Don't forget Shiva for a moment and be distracted by the behavior of the person. Don't see the dirt in the temple or in the streets and get diverted by the beauty of Shiva that is very much living there. Be in the beauty of Shiva. Satyam Shivam Sundaram. Be with that, you will enjoy pilgrimage to Kasi. And be Kasi in such a way, engrossed and enjoy. Bring Kasi with you, bring Kashipati with you, and Kashipati Varanasi Purapati Bhajavishwanatham. We will say Varanasi Puras, the ruler is Vishwanatha. Meditate on that, sing glories of that, and that will take you, give you the highest good that you cherish, not only in this life, but from lives together, lives on, till we are the wonderful, that soul we are, ever free, immortal, ever knowing, full of knowledge, full of bliss, that soul we are, but here bound and suffering, that we want to regain that our nature, and that will happen by the grace of Kashipati, which resides in our heart as our cherished being, whom we call our Ishta Devata. Thank you very much. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu Jai Sri Guru Maharaj Ji Ki Jai Jai Mahamayi Ki Jai Jai Swami Ji Maharaj Ji Ki Jai Jai Ganga Mayi Ki Jai Jai Bhagavan Buddha Ki Jai Jai Isha Musa Ki Jai Sarvastaratu Durgani Sarvo Bhadrani Pashyatu Sarvasad Buddhimapnotu Sarvas Sarvatra Nandatu Hari Om Tat Sat. May all be freed from dangers. May all realize what is good. May all be actuated by noble thoughts. May all rejoice everywhere. Oh, peace, peace, peace be at present.